Everyone has a problem. Regardless of your background or your upbringing, everyone agrees that this world is not as it was meant to be. Have you ever wondered, what's the real problem here? What is the real problem in your marriage, your family, or your finances? Why is there so much strife? Where did all the lies come from? We are constantly dealing with problems. Problems from pride, habits, and identity. The truth is, behind every problem, there's the very same problem. Scripture describes it as the I problem. In this series, we'll discover how to understand and overcome the problem behind every problem.
Country music. I'm fired up today, so I hope you guys have a seatbelt put on because I am ready to go. Welcome to week number 4 as we bring our series, The I Problem, to its conclusion. I also want to give a shout out to those of you who are joining us today from the 11 a.m. Guess where I'm at? I'm over in the loft. That's our venue upstairs in building 242 every Sunday morning, 11 a.m. That's where I'm at. So thank you guys for joining. And also those of you around the world on the internet who watch us, thank you for being with us. Truth is, there are a few different kinds of people here today. One of them, there's some of you that you are in the middle of a problem. That's a bummer. There's some of you, you're coming out of a problem. You're excited that it's going away. But there are others of you, you're heading into a problem, and you're like, no way. Reality is all of us will face problems. Here's the truth, though. We don't always know how to find God's purpose for our problems. And so that's the goal behind our series, to learn how to live God's purpose in our problems. So today I want to talk with you about that one I problem. It's the littlest word that does the greatest damage. We're talking about the word L-I-E. Lie. We're going to be talking about lies today. If you have a Bible, turn to 1 John chapter 1. It's easy to find. Go all the way to the end of the Bible, Revelation. Just back up about one book, and you'll find it right in that general area. 1 John chapter 1. If you don't have a Bible, we'll have everything on the screen so we can follow along together. And I also want to encourage you to take notes today. You're going to have a bunch of stuff coming your way. So in the seat back in front of you is paper and a pen. Help yourself. Or also, if you have a smartphone, you can turn on the YouVersion Bible app. We have a live event called Colonial Church, and all of our notes are there. We want to invite everybody to follow along. Now, by show of hands, how many of you think you know your movies? Think you know your movies? Think you know them? I got a test for you. Here's a test. By show of hands, I want to see how many of you have heard of this movie. 1976, starring Sally Field. It's called Sybil. Any of you remember so? Many of you, awesome. I'm going to put up on the screen here. We want to just get a sense of this movie. 1976 movie titled Sybil tells the true story of a woman whose name is Shirley Arnell Mason. Shirley Arnell Mason had 16 different personalities. She had multiple personality disorder. You say, how in the world can a person develop 16 different personalities? Well, as a response to distress and painful events in her life, she created 16 different versions of herself. Each version served her in being able to connect with people, to find belonging, to prevent her from being hurt further by other people, and also to help cope with the overwhelming pain in her life. Now, everybody help me out. True or false? True or false? True or false? Shirley Mason has reality issues. True or false? It's true. Here's a question. I wonder if the same could be said for me, or if the same could be said for you. In other words, am I living according to the truth, or am I living a lie? So how would I know? Well, I created a little definition of a lie. So here's the definition. I'll share it with you today. Here it is. Definition of a lie. A lie. It's whenever I reject God's view of reality and substitute it with my own. I reject God's view of reality and I just substitute it with my own. Now, the reality is none of us like being lied to. None of us. Like when our kids lie to us, we get angry and frustrated. We don't like anyone to lie. We don't like when politicians lie to us. If you like your plan, you can keep your plan. If you like your doctor, you can keep. We don't like it. People lie to us, we get angry. We feel betrayed. We feel like we're taken advantage of. And here's the twist. Though we don't like being lied to, we'll lie when we need to. Reader's Digest did a study, a recent poll. They found that 93% 93% of Americans admit to lying regularly. 93%. That's a lot of people. Like, why would everybody lie? That's a lot of lies. Well, go the other way. Can you imagine a world without lies? Just think about a world that has no lies. Ladies, do you really want to know the truth to the question, does this make my butt look big? Do you really want to know? No, you don't. Imagine a world without lies. Be very, very difficult to imagine, because I think in a fallen world, when it comes to the truth, we just can't handle the truth. So what do? We cope with life on the rugged plains of reality by retreating into a non-reality, a place called lies, which is the I problem. If you're taking notes today, I want you to write this down. Here it is. Lies are the last refuge of those who hide from God. Lies are the last refuge of those who hide from God. By show of hands, how many of you ever told a lie before? You see your hands? Wow. It's a lot of liars we have here today. And those of you who didn't raise your hand, you're lying right now. We're all liars. Every single one of us. Liars, liars, pants on fires. That's who we are. That's what we do. A couple facts I just want to put on the table as we get started today. Fact number one, God loathes lies because God's nature is truth. In fact, God describes himself in Scripture as the God of truth, Isaiah 65, verse 16. Jesus describes himself, he says, I am the truth, John 14, 6. Jesus spoke of the Spirit of God, and he called him the Spirit of truth, John 14, verse 17. God loathes lies because God's essential nature is truth. Fact number two, Jesus referred to the devil as the father of lies. And we remember just from a few weeks back when we studied Genesis chapter 3 that he tricked humanity into turning from God, and he tricked them with a lie. What was the lie? The lie was happiness means being your own God. It means being like God. And we realize that happiness isn't being like God. Happiness is being with God. And we lost it. We got tricked. We got tricked through a lie. And sin is that I problem that makes us all hide from God. Where do we hide? We hide behind lies. That's where we hide. Which takes me to fact number three. According to Jesus, listen, according to Jesus, lies hide in us. Lies hide in us. In Mark chapter 7, verses 21 through 23, Jesus lists 13 sins that come from within. He says, out of the heart comes, and one of them, lies. Lies hide within me and then cause me to hide from God. Wow. God loathes lies because it was lies that took us away from him. It is lies that keep us away from him. According to God, there's no such thing as a good liar. 17th century theologian Blaise Pascal said it this way, quote, truth is so obscure in these times and falsehood so established that unless we love the truth, we cannot even know it. So here's the question, how do we escape from all the lies? Well, that's what we're going to see today in 1 John chapter 1. Before we jump in, a little background, we always need to get our background so we know what's going on. John, the author, was called the beloved disciple due to his very close relationship with Jesus Christ. Jesus hand chose 12 apostles. John is one of those 12. Among Jesus' 12, he had three that were his inner circle that got to see miracles that no one else got to see. John was one of those three. Of those three, there was one who is called the beloved disciple. John was that one. So John knows more about intimacy with God than anybody. And so he writes this little letter, 1 John, about fellowship or about intimacy with God. The opposite of intimacy with God is hiding from God. And so John uses some really awesome metaphors and word pictures to help us understand how to escape from lies and how to actually have a close relationship with God. And so we're going to learn about escaping lies today. So I want you to write these things down. First of all, escaping lies involves, number one, facing the clear truth about God. You want to escape from lies? Here's where it starts. It involves facing the clear truth about God. One time a young boy ran up to his mom and he said, Mommy, guess what? I'm 9 feet tall. And she said, how'd you figure that out? He said, I took off my own shoe and I measured myself with that. I'm 9 feet tall. She said, honey, we don't measure ourselves with our own shoe. We measure our height by a 12-inch ruler. Here's a question. How do you measure what is true and what is real? Here's the answer. Not by taking off your own shoe. It's not like my own shoe determines what's true and real for me, and your own shoe determines what's true and real for you. John gives a word picture, a metaphor to show us how do we know what is true and what is real. And so John shows us what God is really like through the metaphor that we see right here in verse 5. So let's jump in 1 John chapter 1 and verse 5. John says, this is the message that we have heard from him, that's Jesus, that we've heard from him and we proclaim to you that God is light and in him is no darkness at all. When you notice that phrase, God is light, there's your metaphor, there's your word picture. God is light. In fact, God is referred to as light 6 different times in this letter of John. What does that even mean, though? Like, God is light, what does that mean? Here's what it means. God's essential nature and God's character are the standard and the measure of all that is true and real. God's essential nature, his character, are the straight stick by which we can see how crooked everything else is. It's God's essential nature and character is the standard by which we understand anything is true or real. So in other words, if your reality or my reality doesn't measure up to God's reality, yours is neither true nor real. And so, all of us have a view of God. Whatever view of God you have, if it does not take into account this truth, God is light, then it's a phony view of God. Because here's the metaphor. It comes right from Jesus to John to us. God is light. What does that even mean? So let's break it down. Let's break it down. Just a few things. I want you to notice these things. First of all, light is perfect. Light is perfect. Notice he says that God is light and in him is no darkness at all. This phrase, in him, John's referring to God's essential nature and character. God's nature, his character, in God, light, no darkness at all. In fact, in the Greek, that text, that phrase, no darkness at all, is an emphatic double negative. In other words, morally, God is 100% perfect. He is ever loving. He is never changing. He is always faithful, unlike you and me, unlike every other thing and person. God is light, John says to us. God is then the measure of all that is. We measure love by God's love. We measure purity by God's character. God is the standard. So light is perfect. Second thing, light exposes. Light exposes. How many of you ever heard the phrase, nobody's perfect? Can I see your hands? You ever heard that before? Here's the truth. Nobody is perfect except for God. God is totally perfect, which creates a problem. Because if God's perfect and God is light, then it kind of shows us up that we are not perfect. That's a problem. God is perfect and we are not. And light and darkness, my friends, do not go together. They don't mix. They don't mingle. That's the reality of light. Doesn't mix and doesn't mingle with darkness. And neither does God's perfect nature and our sinful nature. They don't go together. In fact, in John chapter 3, we all know John 3:16, for God so loved the world, and we've heard it, keep going. Verse 19 to 21, Jesus said, and so people love darkness rather than light, so we don't go into the light because we know that we will be exposed. So we don't go there. In other words, God is light. He's perfect. You're not. This is why we hide from God. Because I know I'm not perfect. You know you're not perfect. And if I get near him, who is light, I'm going to see stuff about myself I don't want to see. So I'm going to go live in a land called I don't want to see some things. It's a phony land. It's a false land. Light exposes. None of us measure up to God. That makes us want to hide. So light is perfect. Light exposes. Third thing, light guides. Light guides. No light? You ain't going anywhere. Light guides. God is perfect. We are not. We go hide away. Where do we hide? We hide in the dark. Everybody help me out. True or false? Your eyes can adjust to the dark. True or false? It's true. And some of us have been living in the dark for so long, and we've adjusted so much that we can actually get around in the dark. We can function a little bit in the dark. If you've ever been in a dark place, you know. Just stay there long enough. You'll be able to get around. You'll bang into stuff, and you'll hurt yourself and knock things over and cause damage, but that's okay. You'll do it anyway. Light guides. The good news is that God is light, which means the road is lit to freedom. The bad news is that so often we refuse it. There's an old saying, light rejected is light denied. God is light. C.S. Lewis said it this way in one of his books. I love this. He said, quote, "A man can no more diminish God's glory by refusing to worship him than a lunatic can put out the sun by scribbling the word darkness on the wall of his cell." Listen, God loathes lies because God loves you, and lies take you away and keep you away from the one who really loves you. So, escaping lies involves, number one, facing the clear truth about God, and then number two, escaping lies involves facing the dark truth about ourselves. By show of hands, how many of you remember playing hide and seek when you were a kid? Remember that? Playing hide and seek? I love playing hide and seek. It's fun. You ever think about this, though? How many kids' games that we play made a game out of hiding? Think about it. We grow up learning how to hide as a game. With a little baby, we play peekaboo. We're like, peekaboo. And what happens when you lock eyes with a baby? I don't know if you guys have it. I have this experience wherever I go. If I'm in a restaurant and there's a baby over there, guess who's going to be playing peekaboo? I don't know what it is. Maybe I'm this odd, freakish looking thing. But as soon as I see this baby, they look at me, I look at them, and I'll do one of these. And then it's on. Right? You guys have this, you know, it's on. And so we're doing this, and the parents are like, what's going on? And then they look and like, what are you doing? You're like, playing peekaboo. But what happens as soon as you lock eyes with that baby? Everybody smiles. Peekaboo. Think about when you play hide and seek. You know, hide and go seek, you're running around, and we're hiding from each other. But what happens when you find the person, and we catch, we're like, ah, and we laugh, and then we run around. Imagine playing peekaboo, but you never look up. You never look up. Imagine playing hide and go seek, and you never come out. You never come out. There are many of us, that's how we've gone through life with God. That's our attitude toward God. Like, we're not going to, don't look. Don't look. Do not come out. Do not come out. Why is that? Here's why. There's a dark truth. I'm going to give you this dark truth. Here it is. Here's the dark truth. If you have a pen, I'd be writing this down. Here it is. Something hides in you that makes you want to hide from God. There's something hiding in you. There's something hiding in me that makes me want to go hide from God. What's that all about? Well, it's spelled L-I-E-S. There's just some lie. Jesus said that from within comes lies, and these are the things that make us want to run away and go hide. So how does this manifest itself? John shows us three different ways in which this manifests itself. You can write these down if you like. Three ways that lies or manifest themselves, okay? Three. First one is this. Number one, I lie to others about my walk with God. Hello. I lie to others about my walk with God. 1 John 1:6 says this. If we say that we have fellowship with him while we walk in the darkness, we what? We lie. We lie. If we say we have fellowship with him and we walk in the darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. I want to draw attention to this term fellowship. It's kind of a nerdy Christian word, but when you hear a Christian say it, you're like, ugh, no thanks. But when you're reading the Bible, you go, oh, wow, what's that? So that's what the Bible is to say. In the Greek, it's the word koinonia, which literally means to partake, to share, to be in common. One scholar defines it this way: it's the act of sharing in the privileges of an intimate association. It can be within a group, like a church, or it can also be within a marriage. The act of sharing in the privileges of an intimate association. According to John, this is what it looks like to live a lie. To say, remember he says say, if we say, to say I have fellowship with God, like I'm relating with God, but yet I walk in darkness, I lie. This is what a lie looks like. By show of hands, how many of you think that like a married guy who's dating chicks, there's something wrong here? Show of hands. Well, what's wrong? What do you expect me to be perfect? No, dude, we don't expect you to be perfect. You don't have to be the perfect husband. You have to be a faithful husband. You will never be a perfect husband. You can be a faithful husband. God does not expect you to be a perfect person, always walking perfect. That's not the goal here. The goal is to be faithful, not perfect. See the difference? Perfect is unreal. Why bother? Faithful says what you do next matters. Where you give your heart matters. Fellowship with God. Truth is, there are many of us, we claim to know God, but I'm just going to be honest with you. There are many of us, I'm just going to be totally honest with you because I know some of your stories. There's some of you are very unfaithful to God right now. Oh, I'm a Christian. You're sleeping with somebody. Not cool. God is light. Show me how that works. I'm sorry. What do you just want to be perfect? No, but faithful. You can't be perfect. You can be faithful. That is our goal here. Now let's go back to the Old Testament. The Old Testament prophets, when they were griping about God's people, what was their number one complaint? You're unfaithful to God. That's what sin is for a Christian, to be unfaithful to God. There are many of us here, quite honestly, being unfaithful to God. So what do I do? That takes us to the next verse. Here's your solution. 1 John 1 and verse 7. John goes on. He says, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. I want to draw your attention to that phrase, in the light. And this, he says, if we walk in the light as he is in the light. This is all about walking where God is. Where's God? In the light. It's all about walking according to who God is. Who is God? God is light. Be where God is and do what God does. Like, that's where we should be living. So how do I get there? I'd love to get there. Well, I want you to notice another word. He said, if we walk in the light as he's in the light, we have fellowship. There's that goofy Christian word again. In the first instance, we saw it meant fellowship with God. The second one's different. It's followed by different words. It says, then we have fellowship with one another. Newsflash, you cannot walk in the light alone. Some of you are trying to walk in the light alone. You cannot. You will fail. That's why you're failing. Many of us are doing this version of Christianity called me and Jesus. It's just us and it's okay. That's not okay. It's not biblical. It's why you fail. That's not Christianity. That's called you doing your thing and putting those words in God's mouth. Not cool. Not real. It's a lie. It's a very powerful truth in 1 John 1:7. When was the last time you walked in fellowship with other followers and your sins were known to them and they helped? This is Christianity 101, my friends. But I'm going to tell you, most of the Christians I know, as soon as you like, there's something in their life, you go, hey, man, what's going on? They're like, who are you? And they run away like a baby as if this is weird. This isn't weird. This is Christianity. We walk in the light together. And guess what? If I'm in the light and you're in the light, you're seeing my stuff and I'm seeing your stuff. And if you can't handle it, this is Christianity. You want to go run away, that's something else. But if you want to stay in the Christian thing, it means we're walking with one another. And I want you to also notice what he says, that the result of all this, that the blood of Jesus cleanses us from all sin. Where? In the light. When? With other Christians. Not the blood of Jesus at me at home when I'm crying about the dumb thing I did. No, the blood of Jesus with me when I'm walking with some other Christians in fellowship and we're dealing with this stuff together. You cannot walk in the light alone. Many try, they all fail. This might explain some things for some of us. Again, it was C.S. Lewis who said this. He said, quote, sunlight is the great disinfectant. Whatever you got that's in you, it needs to get in the light. And the best way is to find someone else who's in the light. That together, you can get fooled on your own, but you can't get fooled with another person. Or two, or three, or more. More the merrier. 20's too many. Somewhere there's a line. You figure it out. I'll confess, man, there are times my greatest regrets as a Christian was doing my own Jesus thing alone, thinking I was walking in the light when I was really, in hindsight, walking in darkness because I was alone. Nobody knew. But I will also tell you on the other side, I have no regrets, never, not once, of walking in the light with other followers of Jesus, dealing with my own difficulty when they were right there walking with me. Not one regret. I know it's scary, it's easier to hide, but I have no regrets walking in the light with other Christians, none whatsoever. None. So the first manifestation, I lie to others about my walk with God. Here's the second one. I lie to myself about my own sin. I lie to myself about my own sin. Notice in verse 8 now, he says, if we say we have no sin, we deceive whom? We deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. I want to draw your attention to that word sin, right? That's an ugly word. It just sounds ugly. Just to say it's just like an ugly word. Sin. It occurs 17 times in 1 John, this word here. It's a lot. 5 chapters. Do the math. Like, you want to talk about fellowship with God? We got an issue. It's called sin. In the Greek, it's the word harmartia. Harmartia, one scholar defines it this way, quote, it's the loss or the forfeiture due to missing the mark. To sin is to miss a mark. Question, what mark? Answer, the mark of God's character. Who God is, anything that falls short of it misses the mark. Anything not true to God and his character and his nature misses the mark. Sin is used in two different ways in the Bible. There's a singular sin and there's a plural sins. The singular sin refers to the nature that is inside of all of us, that sinful, fallen, corrupt nature that Jesus talks about in Mark 7, 21 to 23, that out of the heart comes all this bad stuff. That's the singular of sin refers to our nature, our corrupt nature. I don't have a corrupt nature. Okay, be perfect for a week. You'll call me in a day going, yeah, I have a corrupt nature. Pretty bad too. But then you have sins in the plural. The plural of sins is simply the deeds and the actions that we do from that corrupt nature. One is who we inherited this nature, and the other is the stuff that we do from that nature. Here's the bad news, though. We deceive ourselves if we downplay our sin or our sins. It's like, oh, it's no big deal. We deceive ourselves. And here's the good news. Christ died for sin and for sins. He died for all. Jesus died just for the sin that's within us and our nature and also the actions of the whole thing. Died for it all. Could deal with it all. It was G.K. Chesterton who said this. He said, quote, when a man really tells the truth that he tells is that he himself is a liar. Are you okay with that? I mean, here we are, we're together sharing a moment. Are you okay with the fact if you were, like, honestly look in the mirror and go, man, you're a liar. If you're honest, you'd be like, yeah. It's not like I go around lying all the time and I never speak the truth. No, that's not the point. Deep down inside, there's a hider who's always hiding stuff. Everybody answer out loud. Help me out. Yes or no? Answer out loud. Answer out loud. Answer out loud. Does the truth sometimes hurt? Is the truth sometimes ugly? Are lies sometimes easier? Yeah, lies keep us from God. Lies keep us from God. What do you do then? Like, what, now what? Well, here's the solution. The next verse, 1 John 1, 9. John goes on and he says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I want to draw your attention to that term, confess. Interesting word in the Greek, compound word, homo logeo. Homo means same, logeo or lego, that means to speak or to say the same thing, to agree with, to take sides with. One scholar defines it this way, quote, to voice the same conclusion as God, or, here's an interesting one, or to endorse. By show of hands, have you ever endorsed a check before? Make check. Well, yeah, we used to have paper that was money type and you wrote on it. I remember the old saying, it's like, you know, we're not broke. We still have checks. We're good. Checks. It's a form of money. To endorse a check, you flip it over and you put your name on your back, and what you do is that transfers the sum total of that check to whomever you give it to. Listen, God is faithful and just to forgive every sin, every lie, everything that you put your name on and give to him. You did them one at a time, hand them over one at a time. There's so much blanket forgiveness going on, people don't even realize the dumb things they do. One at a time, baby. That's how you did them. This isn't for like people who don't know Christ to come to know. This is for Christians who have trash piled up in their life. In other words, we need to keep short accounts with God. I'm just going to be honest with you. There are many of us here today. I'm just going to be honest with you. As a Christian, you have not kept short account. You've done a lot of dumb stuff, bad stuff. I shouldn't have done that. And you just left it there. And there it is. And you didn't know. It's like in your life is full of the. Listen, when you don't take your trash out, what does your house smell like? Trash. Take it out. That's what the curb is for. That's what the cross is for. One at a time, we say, hey, God, I did that thing. I called her that. And when I lied about that person, and you get rid of them. Some of you, this is your homework for some of you. You need to go away, get a pen and a paper, and just start writing down, God, this is the trash in my life, and I want to leave it on the curb. I want to sign the back, put my name on it, and give it to you. And I'm telling you, you're going to walk away a foot taller. Question, are you keeping short accounts with God? Because if you're not, according to the scripture, you're deceiving yourself. I lie to others about my walk with God. Awesome. I lie to myself about my own sin. And then third thing, I lie to God by hiding from him. Notice verse 10 now. He says, if we say we have not sinned, we make him a what? A liar. We make him a liar, and his word is not in us. Notice those words, him and liar. Who's the him? God. Who's the liar? Well, apparently, according to this text, we're calling God a liar. Here's the interesting thing. That word in the Greek is the exact same word Jesus used of the devil. He's a liar and the father of lies. And here's the deal. We can get into so much of our own reality that we can live from a place hiding behind so much of that stupid stuff that we will actually find ourselves with a false view of sin. Like it says right here, I haven't sinned. I'm okay. Which, from that place, results in a false view of God. He must be a liar. Here's the clear truth. God is light. In him is no darkness at all. That's not bad news. That is good news. God is light. In him is no darkness at all. Here's the dark truth. There's something that hides in me that makes me want to hide from God. There's something that hides in you that makes you want to hide from God. A wise man once said, true freedom is the freedom of having nothing to hide. Can you imagine that? How would that be? How would that feel for you? Nothing to hide. I got nothing to hide. One time somebody asked Charles Spurgeon if they could do his biography. He said, my biography? You can write my biography. I don't care. You can write my life in the sky. I've got nothing to hide. Could you say that today? Because there's some of us, if God wrote on the screen what you thought 10 minutes ago, you'd run out of here with your hair in your hand. There's something in us hiding that makes us hide from God. God wants us to be free. True freedom, having nothing to hide. That'd be awesome. How do you get there? Well, 1 John chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. Here's what you need to know. The chapter divisions in the Bible, they didn't come from God, and so they break up stuff so often and make no sense. This is a classic example of chapter 2 does not belong there. This is one flowing thing. So 1 John chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. Here's the way. Here's the deal. John says this, just hear this. He says, my little children, I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin. That's the goal. Like, let's just be done with that. So you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. He is the propitiation, which is a word that means the atoning sacrifice, the one that resolves something completely. He's the propitiation for our sins. Not for ours only, but for the sins of the whole world, for everybody. Now, did you notice the family terms in there? Children, father. Here's the truth. God wants to relate with you as a father relates to his children. But here's another truth. There's a problem. The word sin occurs there four times. We write that you may not sin, but if you do sin, which you're gonna, we have an advocate, Jesus Christ. He's the righteous one. He dealt with our sin on the cross. He brings us into God's family when we put our trust in him. The truth is, all of us have reality issues, every single one of us. There's something that hides in me. There's something that hides in you that makes us want to hide from God. That something is called lies. And lies aren't just we're walking around saying false stuff. Lies is us substituting our own reality for what God's reality is. That's what lies are. And if we live there, it'll do something bad. Many years ago, Brennan Manning, who is a great author and Christian speaker, died just a couple years ago. If you have never read Brennan Manning, I'm going to just throw a book your way and tell you to read this book. You got to. It's called Abba's Child. I'm going to tell you right now, easy to read, not like crazy scholar stuff, like some stuff I throw at you guys. You're like, are you kidding me? This is like easy to read. Brennan Manning. When he was 8 years old, grew up shanty Irish. Shanty Irish, wear a suit on Sunday to dinner. His mom and his dad beat him bloody on the same day when he was 8 years old. And they didn't know that each other did that. They didn't know. And as a result of that, as a defense mechanism, he backed up from that and he was just like, and he retreated into a non-feeling zone. For 50 years, Brennan Manning traveled around the world, spoke, taught, wrote books, was celebrated by everybody, and he lived a lie. He called the lie that he lived the imposter, and he wrote a book, which I'm going to recommend you, called Abba's Child. In that book, there's a chapter called The Imposter. I will post that chapter on our Facebook page probably later tonight. After 50-plus years of living in a lie, couldn't take it anymore, he went on a prayer retreat. And he spent 3 weeks in the Rocky Mountains trying to pray, meeting with a counselor, helping him sort out why he had retreated, why he can't feel his life anymore. And through the course of scripture and prayer and walking in the light with other people, it became very clear to him what happened. He has been living behind an imposter, so here's what he did. He wrote a letter to the imposter. And in this letter, he thanked the imposter for protecting him all those years. He thanked the imposter for helping him find his way into belonging and relationships when he didn't know what to do. He thanked the imposter for the good things that had come, but then he also went to a point where he said, and now it's time for you to go. You need to go so that I can live. And as a result of that experience, Brennan Manning wrote these words. God loves me, not in spite of, but with my sins and my faults. He does not condone them, but he does not withhold his love because there is evil within us. My friends, there's something hiding in us that makes us hide from God. And today's the day, and this is the moment where it's safe to come out of hiding. Let's pray. God, as we respond in your presence, we can only but recognize that you are a loving, wise Father. You created each one of us. You brought each one of us to this moment, and you desire for each one of us to turn to you, to walk with you in the light of who you really are, so that we might become all that we were meant to be. With heads closed and heads bowed, eyes closed, there's some of you here today. The truth is that your head is swirling around just like mine. And God has spoken to you. And some of you today, you're a Christian. You consider yourself a follower of Christ. And the truth is maybe God's Spirit has spoken to you that you have reality issues. There's some of you here today as a Christian. The Spirit of God has been stirring up in your life and making you aware that you, in fact, have been hiding from God. There's some of you as a Christian that you have claimed to walk in the light, but you are actually walking in darkness. There are things in your life that you have been doing as a Christian that do not measure up to God's character, and you haven't done anything with them. And God brought you this moment so that you might confess those things to Him, so that you might give them to Him. Some of you, you have not taken out the trash in your heart in a while, and the Spirit of God has spoken specifically to you in this moment. This is your moment to respond to God. If you're here today and you're a Christian and your prayer is, God, I don't want to have things piled up in my life. I don't want to walk in darkness and say that I want. I don't want to live in a lie. I want to live in the truth. That's your prayer. Raise your hand right now. I just want to pray for you. Go ahead. Hands are going up all over the place. God, I want to pray that by the power of your Spirit, you reveal to each and every one of us what we need to do, what our response to the truth is, that wonderful truth that you are light, but that difficult truth that there is darkness in us. And so, God, give us wisdom, each and every one, to know exactly what to confess to you, that we might sign it, give it to you, and walk away taller and freer because of your Son, Jesus. There are others of us here today. Truth is, you're not a Christian. You don't belong to God. You can't look to a moment in your life when you turned to Christ and you called upon him. And so the result is your whole life, you've been measuring yourself with your own shoe. You are your own standard. You are your own God. You are your own everything, and it's just not working out. And God brought you here to this moment so that you might come out of hiding, because the truth is, God is light, and in him is no darkness, and there's darkness in you, and light and dark do not mix. And God sent his Son Jesus to deal with your dark deeds, that on the cross he died for your sins, so that when you turn to him, you could be forgiven, you could become one of God's very own. There's some of you here today, you're not right with God, and you sense it, and the Spirit of God is stirring in you, and you sense that you're ready to be right with God. If you're ready to be right with God, it's as simple as A, B, C. A, admit you're a sinner and you need a Savior. And B, to believe on Jesus, that he died on the cross for your sins and that he rose from the grave to give you new life. And then C, to call upon him. Scripture says whoever calls upon Jesus will be saved, will be forgiven. God's Spirit will come into your life and begin making you a new person at this very moment. If your prayer is, Christ, I need you. Christ, I want you. Christ, I'm calling on you right here, right now. That's your prayer. Would you just lift your hand right now, right where you sit? Just go ahead and lift your hand. Hands are popping up all over this room. Those of you in the loft, that's your prayer. Raise your hand. Those of you over in 11 a.m., raise your hand. Those of you online, wherever you are, raise your hand and say, that's me. I'm coming out of hiding. No more hiding anymore. God, I want to know you, want to belong to you. We can pray together right here, right now, in the quiet of your heart. You can just say, dear God, I'm a sinner and I need a Savior. And Jesus, I believe that you are the Son of God, that you died for my sins, and that you rose from the grave. And I ask for you to forgive all of my sins, to come into my life, to fill me with your Spirit, and to make me new. I thank you for forgiveness, and I thank you for new life. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. And everyone said, amen. Let's celebrate together. That's awesome. Yay, God. Yay, God.